Hey guys, and welcome to Build Series. I'm Charles Thorpe. Now I'm very excited about our next guest. The hilarious Jeff Ross is here, guys. Keep it going for Jeff Ross. We have a great audience here in New York City, but if you're at home watching and want to join the conversation, just hit the button that says ask a question or tweet at Build Series NYC. Now, he's probably best known for incredible takedowns on Comedy Central's Celebrity Roasts. Jeff is one of the top working comedians today. He's coming off a string of sold-out dates with Chris Rock and an immersive stand-up special, Jeff Ross Roasts the Border. We're going to check out a clip first, and then we're going to bring him on stage. Okay, guys.
This is the front line of the immigration war in America right now.
That's Mexico.
The border towns are not a place that you would want to come and visit.
Then why are we going?
I don't want people to not know how hard this struggle is.
You wanted your baby to be born in America, the greatest place.
How many people do you think you brought over to America?
Thousands of people.
When we call Border Patrol, we put the cameras down.
I heard yesterday they deported an 8-year-old Guatemalan girl and her 3 kids. $21 billion to build a wall right there.
I could do it if I had to.
But on the bright side, the Olympic Mexican pole vaulting team is number 1 in the world right now. People think United Airlines treats their passengers bad. They're never going to shove coke up your ass and stuff you in the overhead compartment for a couple weeks. I went on Tinder, and I swiped with somebody on the other side of the wall. That's the biggest block in history.
Guys, Jeff Ross, the Roastmaster General, is in the house. Oh, man, look at that. That's you, man. That's you.
Man, in warmer days. Hi, everybody.
Exactly. Welcome to New York City, the bitter cold in New York. Tell me how the idea for the special came about.
Immigration. It was starting to really baffle me. And I always try to do something I think is funny, but also something that I can learn along the way. And I was confused and baffled why immigrants were being snubbed and kicked out and terrorized. And I thought, well, you know, every immigrant I ever knew growing up was working hard and nice people. So suddenly they had this weird thing going on. So I thought, well, let me see what's going on.
And how did it feel to sort of be a fish out of water down there and sort of seeing it for the first time and talking to these people?
You know, I had to immerse myself in border culture. The Rio Grande Valley is not Mexican and it's not American. It's the valley. They think of it as one place separated by this fence. This fence has been in there for about 10 years. This fence
massive,
goes right through this town, you know, and, you know, it all kind of hit me like, I can't imagine if I had family on the other side of some fence that you can only sort of wave at or occasionally visit. So I went down there for a week, and I lived as a border dweller. And I got to talk to migrants just as they crossed over in rafts. I met a father and son from El Salvador who were fleeing the gang violence there. And I met a woman who was just about to give birth, coming from South America. She was just trying to have a better life. She wasn't a criminal. She literally waddled off a raft and presented herself to the border patrol. She wasn't trying to sneak in. So I had a lot of sadness about the situation, and I thought, you know, the sadder the situation, the better chance there is for comedy.
That's what I was going to say. I mean, it's such an incredible experience and great for you to shine a light on this, but how did it feel to sort of want to need to bring comedy to this, make a comedy special out of it? Was that difficult?
Part of my pitch was like the way I did previous specials. I did one in a jail, and I've done shows for the troops where they're in Iraq and stuff on Christmas, and it couldn't be more depressing to be in the middle of nowhere away from your family. And I go, anytime I can bring light where there's darkness or try to get some laughs where there's mostly moping and sadness, to me that's a real fun challenge as a comedian. It breaks it up from, you know, like tonight will be fun too. I'm performing for
Caroline's on Broadway here in New York City, guys. If you're not going to be
the exact opposite, like people are coming away from the news and their regular everyday problems to come to a comedy club to have a couple drinks and sort of escape their own minds. So I wanted to take it to an extreme by going down to the border, and I wrote an entire act just about immigration.
Did you find yourself in any experiences where you're like, I can't make this funny? I can't make a joke right now.
You know, that's a really good question. That did happen a couple of times in the show. I went down here thinking, oh, I'm going to go meet these guys in Matamoros, Mexico, who were deported. And I thought, oh, you know, I'll lighten them up a little bit. I'll make a few jokes, try to make them feel good. But the truth was their stories were so gut-wrenching that I couldn't even get jokes out. I used the footage in the show, and then it cuts to me on stage talking about it, and that's where the sort of pressure valve gets released for the viewer watching the show. But in the moment, there were a few times, and with the pregnant woman, she's just laying in the grass in the most humble moment of her life. And I tried to make her laugh, begging her to name her baby Jeff and stuff like that. But for the most part, it was so intense that I was moved. You can see that I was moved by certain situations. I also talked to some women from Eritrea, refugees who came all through, you know, other continents, all through Europe, Africa, Europe, and then up through South America, Central, through Mexico, to finally get to the border fence. Somehow they get through there, and then they get to Texas, and then they and you talk to them, and their stories are incredible. They also had a great sense of humor about their situation, which I also think shows their strength. And then I do finally get a couple jokes off with them because they were doing each other's hair, and I was like, "Can you help me out next?" And they kind of got that, and so some of the women were so. One woman that I spoke to, she's in the special. She's so bright. She could be a teacher. She could teach English. That's how smart she was. And I thought, this is the best of America. Somebody who's willing to make. Leave home. God knows what she went through to get to America. She's living six people to a room at a refugee house in Texas just because she wants to be able to say she's an American.
It's amazing. I mean, you do have some stand-up in the special as well, right? I mean, who what's the audience made out of in that? What's it comprised of in that? You know, who are the people? Obviously, you're on one side of the border, obviously.
We were right at, I set up a stage right in front of the border fence, which was a lucky break. The mayors, the people who run the city of Brownsville, Texas, it's the southernmost tip of Texas. And as we know, the tip is always the most sensitive.
How'd the mayor like that joke?
And he loved it. And they all sat in the front row, all the people who run that town. And I didn't charge anybody. It was a free show. We just put out flyers and made a Facebook page. And basically, anybody from the immigrant community who wanted to come, anyone at all who wanted to come to the show. We had Trump supporters. We had undocumented people. We had everyone from coyotes who bring people over illegally to lawyers. And Border Patrol, all in one big crowd. And you saw how big the crowd was. We expected 50 or 100 people. There must have been 800 or 1,000 people outside. And normally when you shoot a stand-up special, you do a couple of shows. You use the best takes. I had one shot at it. It was 95 degrees out. You can see I'm sweating through the whole show. And it was, it's a moment. You know, it's a moment between me and that community. And I think I made them laugh and brought some awareness to the situation, but I think I also got a lot out of it.
It's a great thing. I mean, tell me about, obviously, hecklers are in every audience sometimes, you know, but were there any hecklers in that situation? Obviously, things are a little bit elevated.
It's more like comedic heckling, you know what I mean? I'll be like, you know, where am I undocumented at? And everybody, you know, you literally saw a third of the audience go, woo! And I don't know if they really were, or they thought it was funny, or some were and some weren't. But I do know that when we edited it, the Comedy Central lawyers were like, cut to a reverse. Like, we don't want to see the people go, ooh, I'm on, because then will suddenly, you know, Homeland Security will be subpoenaed
reviewing
my footage.
Yeah, exactly.
So we cut to reverse angles. I did a similar thing with when I roasted the prisoners in jail. I said, where my murder is at? You know. It turns out it was three guys in the front row, so... Hopefully the situation isn't the same here today.
I know we haven't really checked these guys out, so I don't know, it could be anything.
This guy I'm not so sure about, but...
Tell me where you got the idea for these immersive experiences, where these stand-up specials taking it to the next level, roasting the prisoners, roasting the cops, as you did.
Yeah. Yeah, I did one where I roast the Boston Police Department.
That was great one. Guys, you have to check it out if you haven't seen it.
Jeff Frost roasts criminals, cops, and the border. You know, there's so many specials coming out all the time, and I've been doing this a while, and I remember years ago, Dave Chappelle, like, I was sort of, like, lamenting, like, oh, I'm getting typecast as the roast guy, and I want to expand. He goes, make roasting, expand that. That's your lane. Make that lane a three-lane highway. Make roasting something else that means something to you. And I thought, well, I don't want to just always wait for a celebrity to agree to be roasted. You know, we roasted Justin Bieber and James Franco and Donald Trump and all these people. And it was always fun. But I wanted to also bring the roast to wherever I went. And part of that was, like, the way I do in my club shows. Like, tonight I'll bring up volunteers from the audience and roast them. We could talk about that later. That's kind of crazy. But I go, how could I do that with different groups of people? So that's when it became, all right, how about guys in orange jumpsuits? And how about cops in uniform? And then I go, immigrants. You know, immigrants, you know, when I was a kid, I grew up in a catering hall, and I was surrounded by Haitian guys who worked in the kitchen and the Scottish and Irish waitresses and the Russian fruit salad maker, and they were really hardworking people. So I thought, and they always had a great sense of humor. And a lot of Mexican American friends and just Mexican friends always had a great sense of humor. So I thought, all right, I'm just going to see if I can get Mexican Americans and Valley dwellers if they would come to the show. And basically, there's a scene in this show where they all kind of line up, volunteers. They come on stage and line them up, and some are dreamers, some are undocumented, some are immigration lawyers. You know, people who would normally be at each other's throats out in the world, you put them in a comedy situation, and they start to connect. Comedy really does bring people together.
Absolutely, and let's talk about the other specials as well a little bit. You know, the Boston Police. I mean, how was it like going into that scenario? Because, right, there was an officer had just been shot in the state, and tell me about, you know, the vibe there.
Well, almost 2 years ago now. It was the height of the Freddie Gray incident, and there was a lot of talk about policing in America and the murder rate in Chicago, and cops were getting shot in Dallas, and cops got shot in New York, and there was a Black Lives Matter rally down Fifth Avenue in my neighborhood, and I couldn't be blind to it anymore. I mean, this was front page news every day. And I grew up in Newark, New Jersey. And I remember my mom dragging me to karate school because she didn't want me to get bullied. She wanted me to be able to look out for myself. I love the cops. My karate teachers were all cops. And I realized, like, we used to run to cops when we were scared. At least that was my impression. But now I saw young people always going, oh, the cops, I'm going that way. And the cops are bad. And they're all, you know, and it just didn't sit well with me, right? I was like, well, what kind of society is that? Well, we're all afraid of the cops. And I didn't see the cops doing a lot to improve their reputation. They were sort of digging in deeper on the way they backed each other up and the thin blue line. And I remember sort of going outside to this Black Lives Matter rally, just walking around my neighborhood. And it really struck me that the posters all said, which side are you on? Which side are you on? And I realized, okay, that's where they stand on that. And I get it. People are being shot and people are afraid. And there's definitely bad apples in the police departments. And I started asking all the big city police departments if I could come there and do a show and do ride-alongs and roast the cops just to see what is going on with the cops. And they all said no, except Boston, where it doesn't always have a great reputation, but an unarmed person hasn't been shot by the Boston cops since 1991. So they let me come in. And when I got there, and the police commissioner, Commissioner Evans, was great. He understood what I was trying to do. He's an old Boston, you know, cop and who moved up to the ranks. But when I got there, the unions hadn't been notified that I was coming, so they looked me up and they'd seen that I was at this Black Lives Matter rally. And suddenly they started with a very similar mantra. Which side are you on? They kept asking me. They shut down my production and they said, why would you go to that rally? If you're here to like humanize the cops, why would you go to that Black Lives Matter rally? I said, well, who would ever watch a cop roast if it wasn't balanced? I'm not here to do a fluff piece. I'm here to like to see what's really going on. I mean, not all cops are bad, but there's a lot of cops backing up the bad cops, and that makes them bad cops, bad apples, if you will. So I start to see that both sides are saying you can only be on our side. And I go, well, what if I was on both sides? Or what if the most open minds on both sides turned around and started talking to each other a little bit? And that's sort of the drive of that show, was to try to humanize and understand both sides of this very, very difficult issue.
Absolutely. And talking about a completely different audience, you know, one that's receptive to comedy. I mean, you just did a bunch of tour dates with Chris Rock. I mean, what was it like doing the Blackout Tour, right?
Yeah, I just did Chris Rock's Total Blackout Tour. We were all over the country. We just did a...
Can you tell us what that was about? They shut off the phones, right? It said there was no technology allowed.
Yeah, I mean, this is where comedy's going right now. I was... We were just at the O2 in Arena in London last week. We did two nights.
Small little venue there.
And Chris likes it when I come out as a surprise. I just come out before him and do some stand-up, and then the lights come on, and I go, who wants to get roasted? And this is 16,000 people in an arena, so people just start leaping out of their seats, and it's pretty chaotic. And I line them up just like I will tonight at Caroline's. You just line them up. And you go one by one. It's almost like a speed roast meets a police lineup meets some other like cocktail party kind of thing. And with Chris, I'm really fearless in my material because nobody's recording it. He has this company Yonder that comes to the shows, and everybody puts their phone in a little pouch. So if they have an emergency and they feel a vibration, they can go to the lobby and open the phone. But when you're there, it's a total blackout of social media. It's kind of fun because there's no cameras in my face when I walk out on stage. And if you get a chance to see Chris Rock's new act, it's fire. It's an hour and a half of, man, it's rock and roll, it's punk rock, it's hip hop, it's like a band. And he's get every type of person at his show, and couples, you know, there's definitely a Valentine's angle to his act, and this is his most, I believe, his most vulnerable act that he's done. So it was a real privilege and a huge learning experience, and everybody comes to his shows. It's really cool.
Everybody loves the roasting. I mean, when you're roasting somebody on that stage, whether it's the Comedy Central ones or on stage, I mean, who are the ones that the people that you really got to, do you think? You know, when we're talking about the Justin Bieber's, the James Franco's, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
In the eyes, you know, sort of got past.
What do you mean? Like
the defenses, the ones that maybe weren't expecting for you to go as hard as you did, maybe.
You know, no one ever expects it's going to be as hard as it is. I think people go, yeah, what are they going to make fun of me? You know, I dated Selena Gomez. I'll be fine. And then you just start tearing into him, and he's like, ah. Yeah, so, you know, I feel like it shows a lot about the person. I never want to hurt people's feelings. When I roast somebody, whether it's at my live shows or if it's a celebrity roast or whatever it is, I want people to leave there going, that was fun. I want to do that again. And guess what Jeff Ross said about me? Like almost like a badge of honor. I want them to go home and brag and repeat the jokes. I don't want to hurt people's feelings. You know, the jokes, the roasting, it should scratch the skin but not break the skin. That's my feeling.
I mean, it's amazing that you're going from obviously these arenas with Chris Rock and then doing this show here at Caroline's on Broadway and then our friend Seth Herzog's show in Slipper Room. You know, it's been a blast. How does it feel to step on these smaller stages again? And sort of, do you always feel the need to like get on a stage no matter where you're at or what you want to get into?
No, it's so funny. Even these arena tours, we flew to Tel Aviv. Chris had a show in Tel Aviv, and he's like, I'm not going without you. I need a Jewish guy on the show. And we got in a night early, and we were with Michelle Wolf and Anthony Jeselnik also, and the and they went to bed. And I took a half hour nap, sucked it up, and went to a comedy club in Tel Aviv because I love that energy. To me, that's a vacation. Trying out jokes for a completely different audience. And it was only a couple hundred people, 150 people, but it was still a good warm-up for the arena show in Tel Aviv the next night. So it's not a big difference for me whether it's a small crowd like this, not even a small crowd, but an intimate crowd like this, or an arena show at the O2 Arena. It's kind of the same material, basically. It doesn't matter, but I am going to miss that rock star feeling of doing those big arenas. That having been said, Caroline's, where I am all weekend, is my home club. It's where I started. The family's coming out. My friends are coming out. Some special guests. So, and because I'm headlining, I can be a little more daring in my jokes. It's my show. No one has to answer for it but me. And two really funny friends are opening up for me. It's going to be great.
That's awesome. What are the topics that you're looking to attack right now?
Dude,
there's a lot going on.
Trump is a big one. I mean, literally, Trump permeates all comedy. But don't think it's a political show. It's not a political show. It's just it's just always hanging out there. Of course, the empowerment revolution is a big part of my show. You know. So much respect for what's going on there, and you know, stay tuned. There'll be a Harvey Weinstein roast at Caroline's all weekend.
Will he be there for that? Do you think?
You know, that would really probably help bring it home, but you know, yeah, no, it should be really
try to
good.
Get the word out to him or something.
So I am going to go through all that stuff, and then I've been getting more personal myself with my own life in my stand-up, and then at a certain point, I'll do a speed roast, maybe a Valentine's-themed speed roast for single people, then I'll do some couples, and then, and then I'll stick around and say hi to everybody and take pictures and stuff. My shows are like a little party.
Yeah, it sounds like a great night. Well, we have some questions out in the audience, so we're going to throw right there.
Hey, Jeff, thanks so much for being here, man.
Sure, bud.
I really think you're brilliant. These specials are journalism. You know, like in an era of fake news, you show and tell real shit, and you're one of the only people doing that. So thank you for putting out this powerful, profound stuff.
Thank you, buddy.
And I just want to ask you if you could
roast... Thanks for cursing before I did.
Hey.
It made me look good, bud.
It's the internet. I just want to ask, if you could roast anyone living or dead, who would that be?
You. Look at that outfit.
Thank you.
You're just like an umpire in Katy Perry's softball team. Living or dead? I mean, you know, you got a shot of this guy or what?
Badge of honor, sir. Thank
you. You're welcome. You know,
roast him too. He's
I always
weird.
Thought my favorite roast would be a Bob Dylan roast. And I'm not sure if he's living or dead or halfway in between. A Bob Dylan roast would be great. A Jimi Hendrix, that would have been a real fun one for me because there's a lot of material there. And I only roast the ones I love. So, you know, when people go, would you roast Hitler? I go, no. No. Would I roast Anne Frank? Definitely.
Oh, that's great. Okay, next question.
But thank you for that, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know what? I was a film major, and I had a journalism concentration in college. So when you say that, and I go, yeah, that's part of it. You know, I don't go into these things with an agenda. I try to learn along the way, and I'm glad that's coming through for you.
Absolutely. Okay, next question.
Hey, that quote about not wanting to roast Hitler but roasting Anne Frank is my new favorite quote of all time.
Oh, thanks, man.
That is genius.
You know what? The thing about Anne Frank, I know this is 75 years ago. It might be too soon still, but when I was a kid in Hebrew school, they made me read The Diary of Anne Frank. Great book. I cried. But then I got older, and I read the diaries of the other people that she shared that attic with, and they all thought she was a real jerk. And keep, won't be quiet. I want to scream. Blah, 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 blah. This is fun.
So,
you're not going to take my AOL account away, are you? Because I'm holding on to it now 20 years. So I'll behave. Yes.
I really loved your specials where you went to the jail and the county prison. And I just thought it was so brilliant at the time also because I think I'd only seen it done once. I'm sure it's been done more times, but I really only seen it done once before you did it. And the way you did it was so interactive with them. I want to know if there was anything that happened in particular that made you want to do that, anything that got you thinking about that. Also, if you had a favorite dais that you've ever been a part of.
You're talking about the jail first, right?
Yeah.
So this was one. This was sort of the first one. By the way, the hashtag is spelt wrong, but that's fine. Roast the border. I think that's spelt wrong, but that's okay. You know what?
We'll get to you proof next time. Sorry about that. There we go.
I went to a county jail. It's similar to the cops in that only one said yes. I asked prisons, jails, even the Folsom and San Quentin, the famous ones, even where I'm from in New Jersey and New York, they all shut me down because it's so controversial. They're so, you know, the jails are so overcrowded in this country. We are obsessed with punishment in this country. And I'm a big believer in second chances, you know. And I remember thinking, America's getting really obsessed with punishment and violence and video games and Game of Thrones. They go, well, how do I roast violence? How do I roast crime? And I go, well, I have to personify it somehow. So then I go, criminals. How do you get the criminals? And what would be funny? Dudes in orange jumpsuits. And I didn't want to know what anyone's crime or alleged crime was before I went. I wanted to just meet all the people that were incarcerated in the moment, just same way I'm meeting you, like not know their background and get what I get from them in the moment. And I remember thinking that, you know, there by the grace of God go I. I sold joints at my prom. I could have gotten busted. All the minimum drug sentencing stuff I was really obsessed with. That people were basically in jail in Texas for stuff that's legal in Colorado. So it's like, what a bummer. And I'm not saying there's not bad people at the Brazos County Jail right now where I was, but there's also some people there that deserve a second chance. And the other thing that struck me when I was researching it was, I think it's something like 90% of everybody in jail and prison right now in America is going to get out someday. Those are our neighbors. If we don't treat them with dignity and a little bit of kindness and offer them a little bit of hope and a chance to maybe laugh at themselves a little bit, that's rehabilitating. So that was my try to, you know, it was my gift, if you will, you know, was trying to do a show. I could have done a show anywhere I want. I had a deal to do anything I want. I chose to do a jail. So I think that's why I did it.
Yeah, it came out great. Okay, one last question.
Hi.
How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing all right. Where'd you come from?
From back there.
Nice. Hiding in the back.
This guy just walked out of a ceiling vent.
Since you've been a roastmaster.
He's been hiding in the attic since this was since this was Tower Records.
I was waiting for you.
What's your name, bud?
Jawad.
How you doing? Nice to meet you, Jawad.
Nice to meet you too. since you've been a roastmaster for so many people, including Trump, Donald Trump that you mentioned, did you have any favorites that you roasted or any favorite jokes during the roast?
My favorite, people ask me this a lot, like, who was your favorite roast? And the genuine answer, and I swear this is true, whoever's next. Because the process of preparing these roasts, like if I'm roasting Bieber, let's say, that means like I have to, I'll start hanging up his picture all over my house. I'll watch all his videos. I'll read all the crime reports and all the gossip. And I'll listen to his music and go, what is it that makes this guy tick? Why is he so popular? What's his vulnerabilities? What's going to make him laugh? What's going to make his fans laugh? Because you don't want to piss them off. So to me, the process, I always say to myself and through life, enjoy the process. Even when things are going great, you know, my manager will go, why aren't you celebrating? I go, you know what? I keep a level head. When things go bad, I don't let it get me too down. When things go great, I don't let it get me too high. I try to stay in the middle, enjoy the process. It's not even about the night of the roast. It's about the month that I'm preparing, getting in shape, getting a haircut, finding a new suit, writing the jokes, trying out the jokes. So whoever's next. You got any ideas? We're looking for somebody. Who would you like to see get roasted?
Mike Pence, maybe.
Mike Pence.
Ooh.
That one could be a three-part miniseries. That'd be a
next
good
special,
one.
Maybe.
Yeah, the roast of Mike Pence. That'll be good. Thank
well, guys,
you, bud.
Catch Jeff roasting this weekend at Caroline's on Broadway. Yeah. Thanks so much for being here, Jeff Ross.
Of course.
One of the rest for Pops.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.